Stevenson's findings, and also contains an additional ingredient that brings it closer to the perfect case of reincarnation, a birthmark. In 1953, when Lavie was two, he started talking about a former life in a neighboring neighborhood. He described several of his previous toys in that life, a wooden elephant, a ball on an elastic string, a toy football, as well as a ring he kept in a desk. He mentioned the name of his previous father, who he said was a barber. Lavie then shocked everyone around him by insisting that he had been murdered. He actually identified his murderers by name and by occupation, recalled that he'd been eating rhubarb just before he was killed, and said that his killers had cut his throat. When Lavie was four, a man who had heard about the story visited the family and told them that his own six-year-old son had been killed 6 months before Lavie's birth in the exact same way that Lavie had described. The names and occupations of the men identified by Lavie matched those of two men related to the victim, who were believed to have committed the murder to win an inheritance. The sad father went on to say that one of the alleged murderers had confessed, but later took it back and was freed because of a lack of evidence. Stevenson set out to investigate the incident in 1964, by which time Lavie was 13. He discovered that his teacher had taken notes on Lavie's claims when he was 5 years old, and Stevenson was able to confirm an extraordinary 26 statements of fact the boy had made that correlated to the life of the previous boy. Stevenson learned that the two families had been acquainted, but that Lavie's father had tried to silence his son, beating him severely on occasion to make him stop talking about his previous life. The investigators thus thought it very unlikely that Lavie was making it up. As a child, Lavie had a phobia of knives and razors and was afraid to go to the area where the other boy had been killed. And then there was the eerie scar on his neck, which his mother had first noticed when he was only 3 months old. When Stevenson saw it, the birthmark was 2 inches long and a quarter inch wide, though he was told it had been longer before, darker than the surrounding skin, and it looked exactly like the scar of a healed knife wound. In another Indian case, the Stevens Indian, not like, you know, how, or whatever. In another Indian case, Stevens investigated, the details were even more bizarre, because they seemed to suggest that reincarnation had taken place in a living child who had come close to dying but survived, or appeared to survive. The parents of three-year-old Jasbir Lajak thought that their son had died of smallpox. His breathing had stopped, and his body had turned cold. The next day, the child stirred, and within a few weeks, he recovered completely. His behavior, however, had changed dramatically. He now claimed that he came from a town about 20 miles away and belonged to a very different class of people. The boy refused to eat the food his mother had cooked him on the grounds that it was not made in the proper manner of his class, and he spoke in a much more sophisticated way than he had done before he had died. He said that his earlier life had ended when he fell from a chariot in a wedding procession. His disastrous fall, he said, was the result of having eaten some poisoned sweets, which made him dizzy, causing him to lose his balance and suffer a fatal head injury. Jasbir's family were very upset by the boy's strange behavior, and except for making arrangements for somebody else to prepare his food, they tried to suppress and silence the evidence of the peculiar going-on of their house. The word of his claims reached out to the other people in the community and eventually to the village where he said he had lived before. Relatives of the late Sapa Ram Tanji heard the story, and because Lopa Ram had died in a chariot accident at the same time that Jasbir had suffered his brush with death, they were eager to question the boy. When they visited Jasbir's home, he greeted them by name and later ticked off several facts about their life. Stevenson later talked to both families and corroborated 38 statements made by Jasbir about Sopal's life.